take a completely and utterly different look at APIs now from what we've just had. So what we've been talking about previously was all about APIs in the aggregate. I'm now going to take a deep dive into what makes a single API good. What's interesting and works really well for an API at the technical level. This is going to be quite a technical talk as a result in certain comparison. I'm an independent API consultant. I help clients integrate APIs, consume them, and I also help clients create great APIs. Or at least I like to help them create the great APIs. It's up to them. I have opinions about this. One of the side effects of having to integrate and consume APIs and help teams to do that is that you discover all the challenges that they come across and how we have solutions for them that are not necessarily being implemented particularly well in a number of APIs. So I want to look at that today. Before we start with that though, the first thing I want to consider is that an API has to be fit for purpose. So when you're designing your API, it has to ensure that it does the work the consumer needs in the way they expect it to. I'm mostly going to be talking about RESTful type APIs here for this rest of this talk, but for some applications, a GraphQL API might be a better solution. If you're in a more, let's call it legacy industry, you might find that you're going to be looking more for RPC or SOAP even. That would be a better fit for your particular consumers. Be aware of that. So these are the things I want to talk about. What are the features of a great API? It's going to be these things. We're going to be talking about malleability. We're going to be talking about correctness. We're going to talk about error handling. And we're going to be talking about documentation. Because there's quite a lot that makes up a good API. Let's look at each one in turn. Good API is malleable. I picked this because malleable is such a lovely word. I really like the word. It's all about flexibility, the ability to reshape. That's what something that malleable is. You can tell that I work with long-lived products. Products that you create at the beginning change over time. So the more malleable your API is, the better it can be. And we can look at that in a couple of ways. Firstly, your representation. The actual data that goes down the wire to your consumer. Decouple that from your internal application build or your database. So you're going to have your database, you're going to have your entities, your application logic, all that stuff. That's your work. That's what your API does. That's your uniqueness in some ways. That is not what you send to the consumer. You send to the consumer in an HTTP API what we call a representation of the resource. The key word there in RESTful APIs is representation. It is a view of the resource. So you should craft it yourself. Don't just take your database design. You will hate yourself in the future if you do that, because you have coupled two things that change at different rates and for different reasons. We change our database and our internal application based on the business needs of our application. We change our representation and the data we send down the wire based on the changes our customers need to use our product. They are two different things. Keep them separate. That leads on to decoupling your consumer from yourself, which is hypermedia. This is used a lot less than it should be, but the really, really good APIs do use it. It creates an explorable API, which enables your consumer developers to actually work with your API without having to keep going back to the documentation, because the API is becoming more self-describing. Hypermedia, by the way, is just a complicated word that means links. We just like complicated words as a general rule in this industry. It's just a link. It's nothing complicated, but it sounds better if I say hypermedia. Obvious advantages. I can rename endpoints. I can move things to different places. I could put them on different domain names. I can move them to different servers. I can move different services because my clients will just follow along with me. So here's a little bit of code that explains this. So I said it'd be technical. Here's a JSON representation in a media format known as HAL. But the key section is this bit at the top, which is the link section. So this represents an order. So we have status of shipped. It's a grand total of 123.45 in UK pounds. And then what will the customer want to do with this data? They've got their order. Maybe they want to get the customer. Maybe they want to get the invoice. Maybe they want to get the shipping note. And I've provided the relevant links directly to them so that the client can go and do the next steps automatically. And I can change those domain names, and the client will still work. Good API is correct. This one really shouldn't have to be said. But the amount of APIs that do not follow the recognized standards boggles my mind. Do not be responsible for bringing more of those into the world. HTTP is a very, very well specified format and protocol. It's been around for 20-something years, and it's only on the third iteration of its standard. It's really, really good. Lots of clever people thought about it. Follow it. They're brighter than the rest of us, the people who created it. Embrace HTTP verbs. If we're doing a RESTful API, we have the verbs that represent what's going on. So get, put, patch, delete, patch, and post. They are used for different things in an HTTP API. Use them correctly. Do not make me use a GET request to delete a resource. That is bad at so many levels, but I've seen APIs that do it. Consider whether you need idempotency, which is another one of those lovely complicated words we like, which simply means that we can repeat the action multiple times and get the same result. That can be really, really handy for APIs that are working in unreliable service areas. Mobile networks are a really good example of that. Status codes matter. Right, we've all seen status codes. We understand that you get a 200 for a success message. We get a 4XX message for a client error. And we've all seen 500 errors in our lives. Things go wrong. If you send the correct status code, the rest of the internet knows what to do. There's this assumption that the client is directly connected to the server, and that is not true. That's not how HTTP works. There are various things in the way. There are proxies in the way and things like that. And they will cache your data based on things like status codes, which leads you to the classic error that you send a 200 back with an error message in it because it failed. What's going to happen now is the proxy is going to cache that. So the next time you try it, the cache will go, oh, I know the response to that. Last time you had a successful error. Let's send it back again. That's why we have 4XX, because all the proxies know never, ever cache an error. Media types. Media types, the content type header, the accept header, are there to enable us to change the representation on the fly, dynamically, over time. I've been doing this stuff for a fairly long while. Nobody was using JSON for API payloads when I started. Half of people weren't even using XML, but most people were on XML. So we were all using the content type application XML. And an awful lot of people believed that XML would live forever. There would be no way we would ever change API payloads away from XML, because why would you? It's such a fantastic format. It's extremely well specified. It's easy to validate. It's extremely easy to interoperate against. It is not a coincidence that SOAP was so popular and that it used XML under the hood. All right, hands up who's built a brand new XML-based HTTP API in the last year? Absolutely no one. Hands up who would use JSON today? We all do. The world has moved. Do you seriously think that we'll still all be using JSON in 10 years' time, in 15 years' time? Maybe, but it might go the XML route. We just don't know at this stage. Media types enable us to change and support different formats off the bat without having to re-engineer stuff. it enables older clients to work with newer clients at the same time. Really, really consider using them. Which brings me to talk about longevity, to how you handle changes. Versioning. Avoid it if you possibly can. If there's one piece of advice I could ever give you about building an API, if you can ever avoid creating a new version, do that. If you always make your changes backwards compatible. Getting consumers to move forward on an API version is extremely difficult, particularly if they are a big client of yours and they pay you lots of money. There's a relationship related to sales do not like you to upset the clients that make you money. And you upset clients that make you money by forcing them to spend money to change an API version that gives them no benefit. You've created your new API version because it's better. Your client, who's been using the old version for the last 3 years, is perfectly happy with that old version. They don't need the new version. All you've done is made their life harder, unless you can provide a value add to them that they actually need, which is surprisingly hard for a lot of APIs. So we can change this backwards compatible. That means you can add new resources. That means you can add new verbs. You can add new endpoints. You can add a new format via content negotiation if you are using content type and accept headers. You can not do things like remove fields. Don't do that one. That breaks things. Don't change a scalar into an array or a list or something like that either. That confuses people. So think about your new version as a brand new API. And you will screw up less. So if you're making a BC break that forces you to have a new version, conceptually, this is a whole new API. We have to persuade all our existing customers to move to a new product. Think about how you're going to make sure you don't break the old product. Easiest way to do that is to use separate code for it. I literally don't care how you do your versioning. It makes no odds in the grand scheme of things. There are evangelists in the space that really, really care about whether it's a domain name or whether there's a version number in a URL. Doesn't make a blind bit difference. It's how you think about it that matters. Server header exists if you need to provide the version number to your consumer. Awesome header. Just use it if you need to send in the version number for minor or patch info. And a great API has fantastic errors. Error representations should be first-class citizens in your API. You should design your error responses with the same amount of care as you design your success responses. And why do I say that? Because all your consumers' developers will see the errors far more frequently than they will see the successes. They will read the errors by hand. Humans will be reading your error payloads. Computers will read your success payloads because it goes through a JSON decode routine and then goes off into the rest of the application. But when an error happens, a human has to work out what's gone wrong. Make that person's life easier because they will like your API if you do. Conversely, if your API errors are totally impenetrable, then your consumer will move to your competitor. They will go on. Who's got time to work out what's going on? Who's got time to raise a support ticket? Because I've got an error. I have got no clue what it means. Pretty print it for the same reason. No, we like to compress all the white space out of our JSON because it's more efficient. That's great for the code that is going through to the successes. For the errors, the human has to read it. Make their life easier. Use a standardized format. Guess what? We have one. RFC 9457, part of the HTTP specifications, how we run the internet. So quite a simple specification, but it provides all the important information that a consumer developer needs in order to help them solve the problem. So this example here, We have status of 503, the service is unavailable. We have a type field, which is a URL, so that the developer can go to your documentation and find out what's happened in the developer portal. Have a title, couldn't authorize user due to an internal problem. We have some further detail that we can provide to our client developer. The authentication service is down for maintenance. It really doesn't matter how often they're going to try. It's still never going to authenticate. Now they know. Make their life easier. Have an error code so that they can string match on it and not have to do parsing of the text. And a good API is documented. If we go back to the importance of actually getting a developer to use your API and get it into production, they are going to end up having to read the documentation, which means they're going to have to find it. One way they can find it is that you could provide the link to the documentation inside your API responses. There's a standard for that too, RFC 6906, the profile header. A profile is defined not to alter the semantics of the resource, but to allow clients to learn about it. It was designed to enable you to provide the docs to this particular API. So once a client developer has successfully found an endpoint, then they can work out how it works and how they can find out further details. Stick it in a link header and you're done. This is really, really helpful for those particularly poor products where they've got multiple sets of documentation for really, really similar APIs and you're never quite sure which is the right one. Canonically, I know which is the right one. It was supplied to me. Documentation comes in two formats. Some for humans, which is the tutorials, and the reference. For the tutorials, you want to make them really, really easy to understand. And preferably, you want to write them multiple different ways because multiple people learn in different formats. Create a video example. Create a written textual format. Provide simple Postman collections or curl examples. Because people learn in different ways, make sure you provide the documentation that will reach them. Someone yesterday mentioned get a technical writer. Well-written documentation matters, if you can. Write great reference material. It actually does matter that we know the details when we are trying to integrate your API. OpenAPI spec is the one you should obviously use. It is the standard that has won. It has got a fantastic amount of use cases once you've written your spec. The most obvious advantage is that you can do design first API development, which means you can get collaboration earlier in the cycle, which is super useful. And there is so much tooling because it is an open spec. OpenAPI.tools is the place to go to find an amazing amount of tooling around validation, mock servers, testing with Postman, client SDK creation. You can do so much stuff other than just create your docs out of an OpenAPI spec. So make sure you use it. So that's it. Those are the key things that an individual API at the detail level should be doing in order to be great. It will be malleable, so it can be decoupled. It will be correct. It will be a good citizen on the HTTP system. The ecosystem will reward you for this. It will have fantastic error handling, which will make it easy for your integrators to understand what's gone wrong. And it will have the best documentation you can possibly write. Because developers recommend APIs for good documentation, which is why everyone recommends Stripe and no one recommends PayPal.